There's one thing everyone takes away from here tonight is that when you start fishing in deeper water, it becomes critical to actually set your game manually. Most machines come out with an automatic setting. The problem with automatic settings is that they don't necessarily work to the local conditions. A lot of the new machines, you do have offsets that you can play with and make them slightly more accurate. But things like water temperature, water salinity, plankton, inversions, all the stuff comes into play, so you actually get a lot more out of your sound than adjust the gain manually. One of the big reasons that people don't adjust their gain is they may be too scared or they don't know how to actually do it, but it's very, very simple. Basically, all you do is you turn your gain knob up, or you turn the button up, and you flood the screen, and as the screen starts, you back the gain off. You see all the, what you do is turn your gain knob up until you start flooding the screen with more clutter. So I'm backing it off until you start losing all this little background noise. And I tend to turn it back up a little bit, just so I got a little bit of noise in the background there. And that's what I use as my gauge. If that disappears, you know that you need to turn the gain back up a bit. If you're fishing in constant water depth, typically you don't muck with the gain. If you start going to increments more than 10 meters, that's when I start to play with the gain knob again. You'll notice I keep saying gain knob, it's an official Fruno, and most of the Fruno sounders still use a knob. And in my opinion, it's still by far and away the best way of actually interfacing the sounder. If you have to remember how to go to the menu and change stuff, it becomes slow, it becomes cumbersome, people start to do it. So you end up just putting up with the rubbish picture of the screen. So one thing to take away tonight is set your gain manually. We get lots of customers coming and going, my sound is only going down 200 meters. They say, we're using an automatic gain. They go, yep. So chuck it to manual, get a call a week later, they go, get 260, 270 meters out of it. I'm going to talk a hell of a lot tonight about beam angle. The beam angle dictates what appears on your screen. Most sounders have two frequencies, and the frequency dictates the angle of the beam. Typically, 200 kHz is the most common frequency you use, and it's got the narrower of the two beams. What it brings to the party is that it gives you discrimination. So if you're looking at a school of fish, if you're looking for individual targets within the school, then 200 kHz is going to give you a much better picture. That said, 50 kHz is also very handy as well, because what it gives away in discrimination, it gives you coverage. So you can see this picture here, 200 kHz, you can see the school, it's got reasonable definition, because it knows what the school sound is. But with a 50 kHz, it gives you a hell of a lot more coverage. So you can see basically where all the school, how big the school is. The other thing you'll notice on this slide here is that on 200 kHz, it's a much weaker bottom trace. When I talk about bottom trace, I'm talking about that little red line there. So it's a much thinner trace and less tails below it. And that becomes quite important when you start looking at bottom hardness. So. A lot of people come and think, they will talk about 1 kilowatt, 2 kilowatt, 3 kilowatt sounders. And it's all a question of power to people. They go, well, I put more power in it, I go deeper. But the biggest advantage of buying a bigger transducer is actually to narrow the beam angle, give you better discrimination. In shallow water, it doesn't make too much difference. If you're fishing out in 30, 40 meters, you're not going to see huge differences. So it's, fishing on 200 kHz, 100 foot of water, your beam angle at the bottom is going to be 21 degrees on 600 kHz, 10 feet on one pillow, 9 feet on two pillows. So it's near the downhill there. But extrapolate that up to 50 kilohertz at 1,000 feet of water, 600 watt transducer, you're looking at 828 foot at the bottom. So that means the fish that appears on your sounder is anywhere within that 828 feet. So you could be seeing fish on your sounder, you're dropping it straight down, and you've got no chance of catching it. And as we go to the next slides, we'll see how critical it becomes to try and narrow that beam angle as much as possible. If anyone's got any questions, any time, just jump on in. This slide here, chucked in here, just so you can, actually it's not through this all the way, just so you can see that people always ask us, when do you change from 200 to 50 kilohertz? When you start losing that red in the bottom trace, that means basically your sound is using its maximum gain just to get a bottom reading. So you should have changed your frequency about here somewhere. Because if you can't see the bottom, you ain't gonna see fish. Typically, big mistake recreational guys make, they go, well, my sounder can see 400 meters deep, so I'm gonna go fishing for blue nose at 400 meters. If you struggle to see the bottom at 400 meters, you've got no chance, absolutely no chance of seeing a blue nose at 400. So typically we recommend if you want to see fish at 400 meters, you need to see at least 800 meters to 1,000 meters. So that's where bigger, better sounders come in.
What finder and transducer were you using on that screenshot?
That's actually a bit of a hodgepodge job because that's actually just a 620.
That's a primary
five. 5-5? Yeah, or 600 watt transducer. So, but I'll just put a slide there just to show you when the bottom trace starts disappearing. Target masking is something that not a lot of people understand, and I'm going to try my best to explain it. I kind of botched up a bit last night, so I'll see how it goes now. When the signal comes down, it comes down in a cone, essentially. And the point where that cone hits the bottom is the point that the sounder marks as the bottom, because all the rest of the bottom gets drowned out in the bottom. So in this situation here, at this line here, which is the most recent history, you can see these fish, but you won't see those fish. Make sense, everyone? So, these fish here would have been seen when the boat was here on the leading edge of the transducer. So those fish would be somewhere back down here. This is where the beam angle becomes critical. So if you're using a wide beam angle, your bottom's going to read a hell of a lot shallower than a narrow beam angle. So any fish that are close to the bottom are going to be lost. Again, in shallow water, 20, 30 meters is not going to make a huge difference, although sometimes if there's an undulating bottom, it will make a difference. It becomes really critical in deep water. One of the questions that we get asked all the time is people go, I'm out there fishing and there's no fish on the sound and I'm catching fish. Most of the time you can attribute it to this phenomenon. But the fish are there, there's something within the beam that's higher than the fish at the bottom. Same theory here. As you go over a rock, it becomes even worse. Your bottom shallows up a lot. You won't see fish in that area until you're past. So, generally speaking, when you see the fish, they're behind you. It's a very common thing. People start dropping their lines down and the fish are behind them. So, something always be aware of. If you're fishing a pinnacle like this, I always recommend coming from a couple of different angles and sort of marking the fish each time and marking the structure. Particularly when a popper comes in handy, you drop a waypoint each time you go to the fish, and you end up with three or four waypoints, and somewhere in the middle of them is the fish. So you watch a lot of the charter boat guys, they know, the local models, they know that when the fish appear on the sounder, they've got to shoot it further forward, and then drift back, and then they'll drop it back. By far and away, the most common form of target masking is actually the other way around, and it's if you've got a gap in the bottom, or a hole, or a crack, or anything like this, if the beam is wider than the hole, you'll never see into it, ever. So lots of situations in deeper water where there's big cracks down there, heaps of fish in them, but you just won't see them, so people drive over them. A lot of that attributed to smaller transducers with wider beam angles, you're just not going to see anything. This slide here is about to spin a boat across, and you'll just keep an eye on how long that target stays in the beam for. So it starts entering the beam right about there, leaves over there. Basically, the speed your boat is doing actually determines what the picture will appear on your screen. So one rock at different speeds can appear as many different objects. Now, we saw a couple of different products that are used for mapping the seafloor. And commercial fishermen have fished for years in the same area. They've got a very, very strong idea of what's down there, because over years they've been driving over rocks and they think that they're not bigger than they are, because the target stays in the beam for a given length of period, it appears a lot bigger. You go and map it out, and it's a little 1 meter by 1 meter rock. They don't believe you. Then one day somebody's brave enough to put it on a scuba set and go down. That's true. So, but just remember, the things that you see on the sound are not necessarily true. The only thing you can rely on a sounder is the vertical axis, the height. So if you go over a bait school, don't look at the width of it, always look at the height of the bait school. That'll give you a truer reflection of how big it is. Just a question that we always get asked. They say, well, my sounder doesn't work at speed. It's not your sounder, it's the installation. Even the cheapest, nastiest sounder will work at speed if it's installed right. This particular one here, I think, is about 50 odd miles an hour, as you can see now. The fastest I've ever got one was on a stager craft up north, at a fundraiser. 350 horsepower on a little stager, and they're getting 110k an hour out of it. Mark Crowley, the race driver. Sounded worth 50. So if anybody here's sound is not working at speed, you want to talk to Rob here, get him down to take a look at it. Invariably, if it's a transom transducer, it's either too close to a lifting strain, it's too high, too low. Normally quite a simple fix, but definitely worth looking at. And you will always notice that most people go, well, it works on 200 kHz, but when they go on 50 kHz, it's noisy. 50 kHz is inherently a more noisy frequency. So it's normally the one that goes first. Okay, I made a complete big zero to explain this yesterday, so we'll give it another go. One of the problems that we quite often see is people get into the menus and they go, clutter. Turn the clutter right up and make my screen look pretty. It will certainly make your screen look pretty, and you end up with something that looks like this here, but you'll start losing fishing with it. Clutter is really designed for if you're running your unit in manual mode, and you've got lots of plankton or sediment or salps or anything up there in the water, and they're just sitting in the background, if they are a legitimate target, but you don't want to see them, you can turn your clutter up, and basically just lets you run a little bit more game than you would otherwise. If you don't really know how to know what you're doing, you can get yourself in a lot of trouble, so whether you should use it or not. Now, clutter should not be confused with colour arrays. Colour arrays is very, very popular with commercial fishermen, charter fishermen, especially in situations where they're chasing species like kingfish, bluenose, hooker, targets that show particularly strong returns. They basically use the colour arrays. On all these Pluto sounders, you see this colour bar down the side here. The colours represent density. So all they're doing is not showing the less dense targets. So they don't want to see every single little tiny bait fish. They're really concentrating on the bigger schools, the bigger fish. They'll just remove some of the colours. You can see up here all the blues and greens. We've removed those colours, and up here we've removed right up just to the yellows. Not really recommended. Normally people knock the sort of bottom two, three colours off just to give a clearer picture. TVG is probably the most misunderstood aspect of sound and widely not used. Is there anyone here who uses TVG? Basically, time variable gain is designed so that if you have a sound that transmitted and used the same gain for the entire period that's listening for, a target that was, say, 10 meters under the boat would appear larger than the same size target that is 100 meters. So what time variable gain does is it, it increases the gain over a period of time to a given depth. So essentially what it's trying to do is make all targets appear the same size. So you go, there's a 60-70 kingy at 10 metres and there's a 60-kingy at 200 metres. The problem is that when you start doing deep water fishing, if you haven't set at a low TVG, you can't run your game nearly as high. So what they're going to do is actually adjust it. You'll see this curve here has a low TVG, so it's got pretty much a linear sort of, it just ramps up the gain over time. Because once you get in the middle, you see the first sort of 10, 15 metres, there's no gain. So you know, we've all set to be the surface, but you start, your gain starts ramping up as you go deeper. So that's sort of a good all-round scenario for sort of mid-water fishing, shallow water fishing. But more importantly, your deep water fishing, you want to turn your TVG up as high as possible. So there's no sensitivity right down to, this case, you're looking at about 50 odd metres, and then it ramps up quite significantly. It lets you run your gain a lot higher. So that's absolutely very, very good to use in deep water fishing. The one time you don't use in deep water fishing is gain fishing, because you'll lose everything at top 50 metres of water, and that's where you're looking for your fish. You'll still be able to track the bottom of your gate with your TVG set low, but it'll be a noisier picture. Any questions on TVG? Most better sounders. You tend to find it on commercial type sounders, so Bruno, JRC, Coden. I don't know if you come across on any of the other brands. Garmin got it now. So most of the better sounders out there will have a TVG function. When sounders are in automatic mode, all sounders have a form of TVG, but a lot of sounders just have it as an algorithm in the automatic mode. So they all do it slightly differently, and some do it better than others. We'll talk about commercial versus recreational sounders. This is an area that's become very, very blurred over the years, because we do have commercial guys out there using 585s, typically fishing shallow water, maybe doing a good long line or something like that, having a little bit of budget. So they'll put on these sounders. They're reasonably good, and you can actually get some pretty good results out of them if you know what you're doing. But more and more, we're actually seeing guys putting commercial sounders onto recreational boats. And if you ever see one side by side, you'll understand why. We can start using those transducers with narrow beam angles. We can start using frequencies like 38 kilohertz, which is particularly good for deep water. 38 kilohertz is actually killer for blue nose. Pretty much every blue nose boat in the country is just using a 38 kilohertz transducer. But the other thing is that you can adjust the gain independently on each channel. You can adjust all settings pretty much independently. So on a recreational sounder, you put it in split screen, you've got 50 and 200. The first thing that happens is your ping rate's slowed by half, so all your discrimination starts to get really, really sketchy. So by getting a commercial sounder, you actually basically have two sounders in one. They're both independent, can run different gains on them. Big improvement. They're no more difficult to use a commercial sounder than a recreational sounder. Same sort of software, same knobs, very simple. They're more advanced options. As you can see from the previous on the TVG, you can actually do a hell of a lot more customizing of the TVG. And it's got things like a dedicated shift button, which I'm a big fan of. Because in deeper water, you always have to use the zoom function. If you're not using zoom and you're fishing 400 meters of water, you're not going to see anything properly. You really want to actually zoom in down on the bottom. And I tend not to recommend the automatic bottom zooms at that sort of depth. They start doing a bit of water ranging, jumping around and showing some funny things. So what I tend to do is I tend to set the range to about 20, 30 meters, maybe 40 meters, and just scroll up and down the screen with the shift button. You'll find most commercial fishermen do that type of stuff. So this sort of covers some of the features that we sort of talked about with sounders. Talk a little bit now about bottom hardness. People always ask me what fish look like on sounders and how to spot a car away from a kingfish or new name, they're missing the point a lot of the time. The most important thing you can use a sounder for is actually finding fowl. Typically, depending on the kind of fishing you do, if you find the fowl, quite often you'll actually find the fish. So, very, very simple. It's actually very, very simple. Where the bottom red line gets thicker, it's a harder bottom. Typically, get the tails below it. And go out there, drive around, see where the bottom gets harder, typically you'll find the fish. Really that simple. Just to prove it works for all sounders, this is on a lower end sounder. See the snapper targets down there. See as the bottom gets thicker through here, it's a harder bottom. See a bit of weed on the top there. Fruta are basically coming out with a whole new range of sounders, and one of the features they've built into them is a bottom hardness, bottom discrimination module. Just basically takes the guesswork out of looking at it, and it actually averages it and tells you what the bottom's made of. So I don't know if you guys can read that there, but it's got a little legend that tells you mud, rock, sand, gravel. And if you use it with the right transducer, they're actually quite accurate. So good for guys that just don't really know all the ins and outs of reading the bottom, but very, very handy. Those sounds go to 587, 627, and then the BBDS one, which goes into the gadgets. This image here, it's quite obvious, you've got a real high bottom coming through here, you've got a whole bunch of small bait fish. The thing that we're looking at here is the weed on the bottom. Quite often I'll turn the white line feature on, and it'll actually show you where the bottom ends and where the weed or where the fish begin. Quite a good feature to turn on. This is an image I took up north, and you can see very, very weedy bottom, lots of kelp through here. These targets all through here are all snapper. I know they're snapper because there's a reserve, so you can see them. But also another thing that we asked about quite a lot is this little guy down here. You can't really see it too well, but it's a second echo. What happens is your sound transmits, it sends a sound wave down to the bottom, hits the bottom, bounces back up, and either hits the bottom of the boat or hits the surface of the water, goes back down again, and it marks again as a second echo. Most sounders these days are smart enough and auto-range to actually compensate for it, but some of the older ones ends up using the second echo at the bottom. You look at half the screen and chuck it to manual. It's also an indication that your sounder is actually your gain is set correctly as well. The Japanese, when we first started getting sounders over here, we tuned them by the Japanese method, which is where you range it right out. Turn the gain up until you got a second echo, and that was the setting of gain. This is a fairly typical sort of shot that you get out in the Gulf and Auckland. I'm sure you get the same thing here. You get this sort of low foul everywhere, reasonably hardish sort of sandy bottoms. You get these real softish targets on the bottom. Those are just the small school snapper, typically sort of school snapper. Quite often you'll actually see these guys throughout the day and not getting any bites. Suddenly they all disappear and you start getting bites. And that's the commercial fishermen always watch for that. They watch for when the snapper go down. Sometimes you actually can see them sitting vertically in the water column, and it's really actually feeding on the bottom. So if these snappers start rising off the bottom, typically they're not really on the tube. But when they start dropping to the bottom, take those. The thing with fish is that people always ask us, you know, what colours, what fish and stuff. You can't really tell, because if you get enough fish together, they suddenly appear very different. That's a bunch of school snapper, it's quite deep. You can see that there's quite a lot of colour in the bottom there. That's just purely because they're that packed together. So instead of throwing back one individual echo, they start throwing back echo on their own. This year, unfortunately, it wasn't up this day. This was actually taken at the top of the South Island. And apparently one of the most epic days fishing ever. It was just a massive, massive meatball of snapper. Deep water, and boys were usually back that day. They were getting one jigs in the end. The easiest fish in the world to spot is a carway on a sounder. You've probably all seen this stuff. You get these long little worms on the sounder. And the reason, generally speaking, why you get that with carway is they're like dogs, they follow you. They come under the boat and they sit under the transducer beam. And because they're in the bin for a long period of time, they tend to show you real long, skinny targets. So, virtually unmistakable. If you see targets like that in your street, 99 times out of 100, they're car away. This is an image taken up further north from here. Bait school with lots of kingies in it. Quite deep, there's 106 metres. Here's a couple of images, some of you may or may not have seen before. Marlin on a sounder. If you're seeing stuff like this down there, so 100 metres deep, big red target. Generally speaking, you're looking at a really large fish, in this case marlin. Same thing through here. You can see because they're such a large fish, because we're on 50 kilohertz, and they stay in the beam for so long, you get those arches. We get asked about fish arches all the time. The only time you'll get an arch is if it actually goes right through the middle of the beam. So if it goes, clips the edge of the beam, then you're not going to see it. You're not going to see the full arch. There's also up here, you can see a bit of feet, and through there could possibly be a thermocline, just with a temperature change in the water. Hard to tell what's going on the other day, but I'll say there's a good chance of a thermocline. This is quite a famous shot in the States. People use it all the time. Again, marlin on the sounder, and you can see there's the Yanks looking at is the fill of the marlin. I'm not so sure myself, but it's quite a famous shot. You really can't miss marlin on the sounder. You don't see them all the time because they're sort of dirty out of the boat, of course, and you've got using the roots and the narrow beams. But keep an eye out if you do see that in the stomach. Not much, not really that threatened up here, but blue cut on the reef. Again, you're in the South Island and you're seeing really reefy bottoms, the high bottoms, and you get these type of fish. Generally speaking, it's going to be blue cut. These images were taken by one of our customers in the South Island. It's actually recorded on 200 kilohertz and 171 meters of water, so quite shallow. Some parts of the country. But you can see Gropa or Hapa, the tension shark, quite often has a real dark red sort of signal. So they're quite easy to miss because they'll actually show up as part of the bottom. Again, same sort of thing, same way I believe. You can see that this on 200 kilohertz, that they're really using maximum gain. So at this point, it's really at the edge of the sounder's limitations. Bait ball. The reason I chuck this in here is that common, I'm not just saying, the common misconception is you see a big bait ball. People always look at the width and judge the size of the school by the width. It's actually the height of the bait ball that's important. So this particular one goes from 13, 14 metres down to 30 odd metres. So it's actually a really big bait ball. If you went over a school and it just went through the outside of your beam, you get this long, skinny targets, and always worth hanging around. You don't know which side you would have went past, but you've gone past it. So. Chuck this one in here. This is actually recorded on a wasp, so it's a little bit hard to understand what we're looking at. This is your sounder in the middle here. Squid tend to show up on most sounders as sort of a band of blue colour, and you often see that during the day or night, they'll actually move up and down the water column. So the commercial guys watch them quite closely, except all their gear accordingly, so sort of get close to the feed. When I was talking earlier about setting their gain, the one thing you've got to be very careful is that a lot of people see a picture like this here, and the first reaction is to turn the gain down and clear the screen up. But you just got to take that context, is that all of this up here, it's just barely coming out of the burning blood, and if you start turning the gain down, you'll start to miss these feathers down here, which are just all through the bottom here. Let's stand up. Oh, actually, I'll offshore better. So just be aware that if you do turn the game down, you might start missing fish out there. You can see all the fishing lines, that's very common. People get really excited and they go, oh, my sound is so sensitive, you can see a fishing line. It's pretty much by sound that you can do that. Same sort of image on a lowering sounder, burning pot going down. If you've ever been to the ENL presentation, we normally use this picture because half the staff are out that day, had a real good day catching all these snapping out here. It's about 15 years ago, really. Any questions on the sounders? Just sort of skip briefly through some other technology that's just come out. A lot of people probably heard of structure scan. I'm not going to go into those sort of hows and wherefores of how it all works. But NSA gives you very, very high resolution images. So this screenshot here was taken by myself and Rob a couple of years ago. Yeah, back away. And these little guys down here are actually dolphins. So you can see the sort of tail up there, the tail. So very, very high resolution images. Not that you'd like to catch them, of course. Yet again, there's a wreck on the bottom. You can clearly see the sort of shape of the wreck, and that's what it looks like in a conventional sounder. But more importantly, I don't know if you can see it too well on the screen, but if you look at the schools of fish around it, with the downscale and the structure scan, it actually gives you a much higher resolution picture of the fish. So typically, in a school of fish, if you see it on an old sounder, you're looking at just the density. Can't really sort of pick out what size the fish are. You can't tell if it's jacks or kawai or kawaii. You can't tell how big the feed is. The structure scan actually gives you a much better chance of actually seeing the size of the bait in there. Actually, another tool to help you determine what you're looking at. Again, here you can see that this is dropping off a bunch of sand through here. Real bouldery stuff. You can see very clearly the weed on the bottom as opposed to on a conventional sounder. Real good for if you're straight lining and you're looking for the weed edges, you really want to anchor off of the sand, sort of drift back in and place your base close to the rocks. The latest version of, I don't want to get too much into product placement, but the latest version of the Lorenz, the HPS2, they've actually come up with a way of overlaying the structure scan directly onto your chart. Quite handy, so it makes it a bit easier for people to understand. A lot of people struggle with the understanding how to read the structure scan. So they make it a bit more palatable by putting it onto the chart. You can see where the rocks are. This particular image, I believe, is a recording from Java. Again, another image of structure scan, you can see sort of through here, where the contours here are actually marked through here. You can see sort of a small beach through there. Another product we sell, and going back to what I was talking about earlier, is that more and more people are getting into trying to map the seafloor. There's more and more products coming out with bathy charts, but a lot of the information is either outdated or just downright inaccurate. It sure looks pretty on a plotter, but there's no such thing for actually generating your own data. So this program here is called MaxSea. It runs on a PC, connects with your sounder, connects with your GPS, and as you run over things, it starts to add points, and you end up getting 3D images at the bottom. You get things like this pinnacle through here, this big rock through here. That's without a PVG on, that's with the PVG. So, very good for the kit. Again, a lot of commercial guys use it, a lot of crayfishermen, a lot of charter boats are starting to use it as well. They're just trying to get an edge on everyone else. This is the same program, MaxSea, but Rob has been clever enough to actually manipulate some newer bathy data and put it into the system. So we can display that in 3D, we can put it to a contour file, pretty much anything you want. So it's very, very hard to actually download the files. It takes a lot of time, but if you're really interested, you can talk to Rob and see what you can come up with. Getting a bit into the big stuff now, just want to talk about something ENL actually manufactures. It's a product called Wasp, outside of most people's price ranges, but a bit of fun to take a look at. Essentially what it is it's a multi-beam sounder. So instead of having one beam facing straight down, has 112 beams that cover 120 degrees. Each one of those beams is 1.1 degrees. So if we go back to the right back video presentation, we're talking about the, you know, try and make the beam as narrow as possible. Well, 1.1 degrees is about as narrow as you're ever going to get. But if you have one beam, you lose coverage. So with 112 beams, you know, cover the bottom and get there. So this image here comes from the States. I've done a sea trial, dropping from about 50 meters down to near 1,000 meters. You can see what would be good for broadbill fishing, imagine. This is the reason why I kind of stuck it into the presentation tonight, because a lot of you guys will recognize this reef. We couldn't map this particular area here because there's a ship park there. But it just gives you an idea of just what the bottom actually really looks like. All of these little bits of reef hanging around the outside, and it's quite a sheer sort of reef out there. It's a big lump of rock out there. That's the same thing in two dimensions. So you can see the reef actually extends quite far out. Lots of these buggers out there now. These are the containers that came off the reef. The company that did this mapping is a local company. They were tasked with finding all the containers. Unfortunately, most of the containers when they actually hit the bottom were all broken pieces, so they're particularly hard to find now. And it's interesting that they've all become little ecosystems. So they're part of identifying the containers, they have to drop a camera on each one, and there's actually already sort of fish starting to move in their little ecosystems. Unfortunately, they have to pull them all from the bottom as part of the contract. So they know where most of them are now, but even the ones that are completely not causing any trouble, they're still pulling from the bottom. If you compare that to the image we showed you on a structure scan earlier of a wreck, this is a similar sort of scenario. This is the wreck at the bottom of White Island, after Whale Island. You can see the sort of discrimination you get. So bow through the stern, wheelhouse and the stern. Just a couple of sand waves. Just showing how accurate the sound can be. I'll just show you all these little sand waves as you drive through the bottom. One of the features that most commercial fishermen should know what is that not only does it show you the depth by colour, which is this image here, it will also show you bottom markers. So you can see that big lick of sand is actually coming into this bay here, being pushed in by the current. So again, I keep going back to bottom markers, but most good fishermen are always constantly looking at the bottom, trying to determine what the bottom is made of. It makes a huge difference in the type of fishing you do. And people always talk about bathy charts and contour charts and stuff like that. Well, this is an area not too far away from here. I can't say where it is because it's confidential. But that's mapped down to 1 meter resolution and 1 meter contours. So absolutely unbelievable if you're out there fishing. The system is, because it's not just a mapping tool, it's also a sounder. We can actually record the fish calls. So go through the history and we can actually see where the schools were, how big they are. You can actually pan and rotate around it in 3D. So you just see here, we put a line across the screen up here. We're just measuring between two points and measuring the height of the and the contour of the area. So what becomes quite interesting is that because it's mapping 112 degrees either side of the boat, when we go over a school of fish, we can actually see which side they go and how big the targets are. So it's great if you're out there mapping an area, you can actually see exactly where the fish are in relation to the boat. So you can always come back and get on top of them. You can see down here, this is a triple beam sounder, so it's mapping three different beams. You can see there's very few fish in the center beam, all the fish are off to the starboard side. Same scenario there, you can see a big school of fish going off the port side. We talk about coverage. With no loss of discrimination, looking at 200 metres of water, we're mapping 600 metres, so about three times the water's depth that we're looking at either side. The deeper you go, the wider it gets. So you can imagine on the 80 kilohertz version, when you're fishing in sort of 1600 metres, you can cover 1800 metres at the bottom, basically. Very quick to find new areas. That's about it for tonight. Any questions? That's what a gold question. The retail price is about $50,000. A hell of a lot of fishing, but they proved it to be very, very popular. We sell about, I think our best year so far was 250 a year. Mostly obviously offshore, but several things you know as well.
So your trade price is pretty good then?
Sorry?
Trade price is pretty good then?
Oh, absolutely.
Sometimes
we answer it, do you? You'd be very surprised to know how many boats around this area would be using systems like this. So.
And tube technology, what's your
good? I don't really know enough about it. About